A very good afternoon to everyone. Welcome to the episode 3 of JLU Knowledge Series Season 1. We today would be interacting with Mr. Harish Goyal, CEO, Health and Wellness, ZSL Group. The fireside chat would be moderated by Professor Jayant Panda, Head, Jagran School of Journalism and Communication. I request Jayant sir to please take it from here.
Thank you, Radhika. It's been a wonderful good afternoon to all of you. And again, on behalf of the Jagran Lake City University, I formally welcome you to the 3rd episode of most enlightening, inspiring JLU Knowledge Series. First of all, I would like to extend a special and warm welcome to our distinguished speaker of the day, Mr. Harish Goyal, CEO of G Entertainment Enterprises Limited, Asia Pacific, Africa. He is joining us from Singapore. Very good afternoon, Harish ji. And very good evening, Harishji. In fact, in Singapore, I remember that is around 2.5 hours ahead than us. So I wish you have a wonderful evening there.
Namaste. I have a privilege to... Namaste, everyone.
Thank you. I have a privilege to welcome my mentor, a frontline PR guru, and a brilliant strategist, Divakar Shukla ji, Dean, Faculty of Journalism and Creative Studies. Very good afternoon, Divakar ji. And in fact, thank you for giving me this opportunity to interact with the world's top class CEO. Yes. And I had remembered that when I first interacted with him, it was so pleasant and so informative. That is, I believe there is a lot of takeaway. And I believe today's interactions will also create a milestone, and our students, they have a lot of takeaway from our interaction. Before I formally introduce our speaker, I would like to give you a brief idea about JLU Knowledge Series. Being a leading university, we try to achieve our academic excellence at par. Over the year, we develop ourselves as a premier institute in this part of the country. Different rating agency acknowledged as a top-rated university in Central India. We committed to take this mission globally. This JLU Knowledge Series is a step ahead towards this mission. We invite global leaders for a dialogue and try to understand their life journey, their challenges, their success mantra, which inspire our young mind and future leaders. Moving in this direction, we have a privilege to introduce our distinguished speaker, who is multifaceted, multidimensional personality, and a true global CEO. Mr. Harish Goyal ji, CEO of G Entertainment Enterprises Limited, Asia Pacific and Africa. He also the CEO of Health and Welfare Venture of SL Group. Engineer graduate by education, but successfully managed several business ventures globally. He is instrumental in launching and spearheading lots of international channels globally, like G World, G Magic in Thailand, G Bioscope in Indonesia, G Bolly Movies, and G Bolly Nova in Africa. He was also successfully undertaken the leadership position such as Vice President, Times of India Innovative Media Project, Chief Marketing Officer, SCM Group, General Manager at Bharti Teletech Limited, GM Cosmo Limited. During last 25 years, he is actively involved in setting up overseas business operation in 3 continents and over 70 countries worldwide. It is an honor for us to you as our speaker of this session, Harish ji. It's a truly inspiring your journey from an engineer graduate to a CEO of a leading media house. Please take us through such an adventurous journey and reflect few of your challenges you had faced in your initial days. Over to you, Harish ji.
First of all, namaste, and thank you so much for having me speak to the faculty, the dean, and the students. So let me not forget that, you know, I was your age. I was the age of a student. I was a student just, you know, about 2 decades back. So I can understand the anxieties and the situation a student is when he is at the verge of, you know, I would say, you know, inflection point wherein from being student to being professional, from being a boy to being a manager. 25 years back, I was in the same situation, and I'm today going to take you back where I started. So initial, part of my career, I wanted to be a researcher. I am an electronics engineer. And that point of time, I remember in final year of my engineering, I filled in what I want to be. I wanted to be a researcher. And there used to be a famous Amir Khan song that all of us used to hear in our hostel. Papa kehte hain bada naam karega. So that was my age. Please, boys, those who actually remember this song, they must know how inspiring the song was for me at that age. And rightfully, I started my career as a researcher in the foothills of Himalayas, inside a research lab. After about 10 months, I realized that these hills don't speak. They remain where they are. I used to drive past those hills every morning, every evening. I used to look outside window. And after a while, I remembered even, every tree on the hill. And alongside my family started telling me that if you want to be big, you have to come to a big city. So I decided to move and take a transfer from being engineer to the corporate office of my company in Delhi. And from here, I must say that, I did everything in life that I disliked. I never wanted to live in a big city. I lived in a big city. I never wanted to live in an apartment. I lived in an apartment. I wanted never to migrate to another country. But the fact is that, life gave you what you always actually try to avoid. So my first message to you young people is that, nature has made life very, very simple. Let's keep it simple and let's, as a human mankind, let's not try to complicate it. From after, about first 3-4 years of my life, I started taking life as it came to me, which means I stopped resisting. And that is when the best part of my life actually started. I will just, before I go further to, how my life used to be 25 years back. Just imagine that the means of communication when I started my work life was telex. I'm not sure how many of this. Telex means you could only write 10 words or 20 words to convey the entire essay or the entire email or the entire letter. It was not the age of WhatsApp wherein actually, you make a lot of emojis. And the communication never stops. So which means there was a limited communication, but it used to be very, very meaningful communication that we used to have in our early part of career. And then came fax, of course. In my age, the phone calls used to be booked phone calls, trunk calls, which means, we used to call an operator and say that, please connect me to so-and-so in Germany at this number. And the operator used to call us back. It was not the age wherein you pick up a phone. And I remember I spoke to Dr. Panda for an hour. I spoke to Arshi probably a dozen times. And so the convenience of this, extensive communication was missing. And when we used to travel, that was the age of blanket permits, which means I used to get less than $100 per day for traveling. And in those $100, I had to manage my hotel, my 3 meals, my transport, and my business. It was not the age of credit card. We used to carry the traveler checks. And when I used to go on a business trip, it was not an everyday call back home. I used to make a phone call from the phone booths. Look at the convenience of today from, the early 90s. what I explained to the late 90s, wherein telex got replaced with email, trunk call got replaced with a mobile phone, not even pager, and Foreign Exchange Regulation Act got replaced by Foreign Exchange Management Act from, you know, FERA to FEMA. That was a big change. And you have to also visualize the image of India, what in world sees us as India post Pokhran test by Dr. Abdul Kalam. That was a very important milestone, I must say that. And the soft power of India that we emerged as. Today, we are known as the world's soft power. And I had given some example. I'll of course give an example. I'll take a pause before moving further, because you know I need to understand from Dr. Panda and everyone that am I moving in the right direction? And then you know I'll request you for the next question, and I'll come back to this first question again.
Sir, as I said, that entirely our conversation is a free flow conversation, and probably to understand your perspective, being a CEO, you will be ultimately, as I remember, being a CEO of any leading global outlet, you will be the ultimately be responsible and accountable for everything what you plan and what you delegate as a role of CEO. So probably I try to understand, how do you plan to delegate your role as a CEO?
Thank you, Dr. Panda. So let's understand, you know, all of us are cricket fans. If not all of us, most of us are cricket fans. So what cricket is actually not only the captain, it's the team.
True.
So in our business also, it's a team that is important. Captain is someone who actually, of course, lifts the trophy when team wins it. But without the team's effort, a trophy cannot be won by only captain. So which means what I am, it depends on what kind of team am I having. Of course, I am the front face of the team, and which means that I can't, and my team can't afford me to go wrong. So that is the, of course, the extra onus on me. But every time team wins, I get a chance to lift the trophy. And so being a manager, you must have one complete trust on your team, and vice versa, which means team must have trust on you. If there is lack of that, we'll be fighting that fight or struggle every day. So that is why we call it team management, or you know, a teamwork and all, which is very, very important. And at the same time, now I must say that in last 25 years, what I learned is everything else is manageable, can be managed very, very well, except human being. This is the most complex element that we struggle to manage. And every day, a lot of time actually is spent on managing that.
It's a very rich, insightful, Harishji. Probably I would like to move to from managing an industry to managing a media house. As I was associated with lots of media houses, and I also part of their launching team, I clearly understand the challenges, tasks, and planning what we undertake. Perhaps I would like to know your perspective in positioning various international channels in different country, and how you manage so many channels across the globe. That probably it will give you a very good perspective to our budding media entrepreneurs.
Thank you, Dr. Panda, for an excellent question. So from first of all, I am not a media specialist. It's been 7 years. Of course, I am heading this business. But then, you know, I am every day learning from the colleagues and from the team. So I am going to give you a perspective of not only India, but a global business, right? You know, when we are in India, so you have to first of all define what is your canvas. is your canvas Bhopal? Is your canvas Madhya Pradesh? Is your canvas India? Is your canvas Asia? Or is your canvas the world? And once you have defined your canvas, you can actually, you know, then think that, you know, what if it is a matter of launching a product or a service, what is the market that you are catering to? Like when I went to South Africa in 2014, 7 years back, there was a lot of confusion among the people who spoke to me whenever they heard the name Z. Because almost every South Asian I met in Africa or every expat I met in South Africa asked me this question that, you know, assuming that I'm catering to South Asian viewers in South Africa or South Asians. South Asians means, you know, Indians, Pakistanis, Sri Lankans, Bangladeshis, all those who speak and understand Hindi. That probably I am there to cater to this market of South Asians. And I had to clarify to them that over there are only about 1.5, 2 million South Asians in South Africa and whole of Africa. Whereas Africa as a continent has 1.3 billion people, almost as much as India. So the canvas, is it, you know, I'm catering to 2 million people or I'm catering to 1 billion plus people? That was actually, you know, the first defining point, which defined as to what is the kind of product or a service I'm going to be launching. So the first launch that I did ever in my media life was in 2015, February, which is, you know, getting close to 6 years, plus years now in another few weeks. That was actually, you know, launching a Bollywood channel in English. This was channel known as Z World. It was world's first Bollywood channel, general entertainment channel in English. So you can imagine that, look, you know, it's been so many years, you know, so many decades that our industry exists, but no one ever thought of launching Bollywood in English.
True.
And it was prepared to launch, and the amount of research that went behind launching this product is phenomenal. You know, for that, you know, there has to be a separate session as to, you know, how we conceived our channel, how we customized our channel, how we adapted it to suit African viewers, and why it is one among the most successful channels of Africa now. The channel is one among the top three performing channels in most of the markets, be it Nigeria, be it South Africa, Zambia, or Kenya. The number of 70, I mean, there are about 44 sub-Sahara African countries in which English is spoken. Now that I have told about English, the next point for our media life has to be, because media is all about communication. It is all about, you know, communicating right. So which means when you are launching or thinking about a product in international market, you have to actually think either on the basis of language, like, you know, I classified my products on the basis of, and my services on the basis of language. So first product I launched was in English, Z World, and within 7 months, I had launched another product in French, which is actually, you know, spoken in 26 countries of Africa, and those countries are known as Francophone Africa. So having launched English and French within the, you know, the first year of me taking over this business, people started speculating that, you know, the next obvious choice is a channel in Portuguese language, because Portuguese is the third most spoken language in Africa. And those countries who speak Portuguese are known as Lusophone countries. And at the same time, once you do something, your competition start tracking you. Your competition want to actually do the similar services. And so a lot of people try to do that again. But not everyone could actually succeed as well as, you know, what we could, because of the customization, understanding your customers with the eye of research was very, very important. So the similarities that when we did the research between India and Africa, we learned that people from both India and Africa love colors. The dresses are colorful in India, dresses are colorful in Africa. You see the, you know, it's only a black person who can afford to wear a red color, starking red in Africa. That's possible only there. And the love for music. People love music here in India and there in Africa. And love for dance. Fantastic. That was the similarity which we first drawn. And after that, you know, we understood that a lot of similarities exist between the continents. Like, you know, in India, elder siblings are expected to take care of the younger one. It is the same way in Africa that, you know, elders are actually, you know, expected to taking care of the younger siblings. And now that, you know, I have said that customization, I have said the language, but then I have also spoken about competition. At the same time, you have to also think, what is your USP? What is your unique selling proposition that you have and others don't have? So our USP, when we actually launched products in various markets, was our content was 3 generations safe, which means grandparents, parents and grandchildren could sit together in front of TV and watch our content with absolute confidence that nothing unrequired will be shown or spoken on the channel. Compared to the content, which actually, you know, is very edgy, wherein at any point, something that, you know, can start happening on screen that a grandfather or, you know, a parent don't want to see it sitting together with the children. So we had to actually, you know, we had a very, very unique proposition of, you know, expressing romance, which means, you know, people of my age can understand 2 flowers just, you know, trying to get close with the wind flow, unlike the lips kiss or the French kiss and, you know, multiple kind of ways of expressing. So understanding your audience is important. Unique selling proposition, which means USP, is important. Customization and adaptation is absolutely important. And that is not, I would say, the end of what else is required. In the interest of time, I'll just, you know, I have listed the 3 important things, but there are other important factors also that one can speak at later stages. Thank you.
So as you know that we are transiting through a pandemic situations, and I feel, I take it as a very positive note, that we are very fortunate to witness this pandemic and disruption it caused. Most of the business houses shrinking, media outlets were closed down, revenue generation was declining trend, lots of retrenchment and job losses were the few outcome of this pandemic. But going against all odds, you dare to launch a channel right at the peak of the pandemic in Africa. So probably I'm very inquisitive and very curious to know what was the planning and how you think to launch a channel during this lockdown period.
Thanks, Dr. Panda. You did your thorough research. So what you're saying is right, actually, you know, pandemic, it has been, had been a really challenging 1 year. I remember when I actually, you know, when the new year started, we had just finished partying and I went, tried to go back to work in the first week of January. I got a call from my house saying that, look, you know, bring some mask and sanitizer when coming back. I'm living in Singapore and I realized that when I went to the shop to buy mask and sanitizer, they were out of stock. On 6th of January, and our lockdown started after 15th March. So you can imagine that in this global age, even if the information is flowing fast, how much time we human beings take to absorb and understand the seriousness. But at the same time, masks were out of stock, sanitizer was out of stock, and the shopkeeper said, "Sir, our Chinese customers and Chinese companies from China have bought all the stock and it has been sent back to China." So I will not speak more on that topic, but I can actually, you know, I carry a lot of knowledge on as to, you know, what was going on in the initial part of COVID-19, when it was not even known as COVID, it was known as Wuhan virus, and then coronavirus, and then, you know, COVID-19 name was given. And I was telling someone that recently I started reading COVID-20 somewhere. So which means another name has been given now. A lot of people are in India probably are not reading about COVID-20. But, you know, there are news coming around that. Coming back to the challenges, let's also understand where there are challenges, there are also innovations and there are also opportunities, because most of the world stop thinking when they see a challenge, because people are grappling to fight challenge. And that is what exactly was happening in my business also. Most of the competition and business had actually stopped thinking about launching anything new in 2020. And in March, lockdowns across the world started. So from 19th March, I was stuck in Singapore. I just came back from South Africa to Singapore, because Singapore closed its borders after a week from 19th March. And then, you know, Prime Minister Modi announced one day ban, and then, you know, the entire lockdown started in India and global news started coming. So my team was based in South Africa. I was in Singapore, and the channel that I wanted to launch was in Amharic language, which is spoken in Ethiopia. Right. And Ethiopia was not having any studios where production and the content could be produced. So the challenge was, I was to find someone, some location where there is not a lockdown, first of all. So we started searching the countries where there is no lockdown or there is no curfew. And for next 3 to 4 months, where we felt that there is not going to be a curfew and lockdown. And we found that Kenya actually was not having the COVID-19 because of a lot of vaccination, which were of different kind that had happened. And in Kenya, because of the other pandemics or the, you know, diseases in the past, they were anyway using sanitizer, they were using a lot of other practices. So the country was open, and at worst, country was expected to go down in the night curfew. So which means the country was found. Now the challenge was, how do we find people who speak Amharic language? Because for producing our content, we needed Amharic speaking people. And fortunately, we found a refugee area. Ooh. Wherein some of the Ethiopian people had migrated, and they were living in a portion of Nairobi. And that's when we started producing our content using the high speed fiber. So technology, we should not forget. I started my discussion from telex to the fax, to the mobile phones, to the emails. And what 2020 did, actually, it suddenly fast-tracked the rollout of 5G across the globe. That is some, you know, another positive which we should talk at a later stage as to, you know, what all have been the positives that happened in 2020, while challenge of 2020 is known to everyone. So this 5G rollout happened, I would say it has been fast-tracked 3 to 5 years. So last year, extensive 5G rolled out, and using this pipe of fiber, we actually sent our content from India to Kenya, Kenya to South Africa, South Africa to India, and the transmission back via satellite and fiber to the customers. Channel was launched in June 2020, and it had been one successful mission wherein I continued to be based in Singapore. My team continued to be based in South Africa. The product was launched in Ethiopia and product was produced in Kenya. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a very good, it's nice, insightful, and probably we are taking this technology, and this pandemic is also give a leverage of lots of OTT platforms, and probably the viewers, I believe they are switching to OTT platforms, and at the same time, it would be a threat for your legacy television channels. So switching to OTT platforms, how you see such changes, and would it be a threat to your traditional television channels? Because as you were said, that 5G is rolling out, and we are also at an leverage of interacting with virtually. And now this young generations, they are found that this online OTT platforms, they are more comfortable, and they are simply switching the screen to small screens, and they are attaching with this OTT platform. So do you think it is a threat for traditional television channel?
Very good question, Dr. Panda. So let's first of all understand what are we talking. We are talking about linear channels. We are talking about OTT. OTT is over the top. And my personal view is it is not linear versus OTT.
Zoom meeting.
The two are competing, but at the same time,
linear
and OTT. Which means, you know, it is one is complementing the other. So again, defining your canvas, this answer could be depending on whether you are seeing it from the eyes of India or whether you are actually, you know, wanting to answer it from the perspective of American business or a European business or a Asian business or a African business. So this question, if I have to answer wearing different hats, my answer is going to be entirely different every time, you know, I change the hat. However, just to sum up from the global perspective, because eventually we are not talking about Bhopal, we are not talking about Madhya Pradesh, we are not talking about only India, we are talking about the global business. And my own experience has been that OTT is, of course, growing. There are a lot of research reports. You will see that OTT business is growing, volume is growing, business revenues are growing. But the question is, when is the inflection point where OTT revenues will overtake the linear business revenues? I'm not seeing that stage right now. I've not seen that stage in the last 5 years. One thing is certain, that consumption of content has gone up. A people of my generation, I'm still watching linear television on set-top box or on cable TV because I don't want to waste my time in deciding what do I want to watch. I want to leave that to someone, the linear channel producer, as to, you know, what he want to show me. At 8 p.m. when I sit for dinner, or at 7 p.m. when I sit for dinner. And my consumption at the same time on OTT platform has also gone because I have started consuming and watching content on OTT now. So I watch my linear channel and I am also watching OTT, which means the overall consumption has gone up. I have not given up my subscription to the set-top box or cable TV. At the same time, I'm subscribing to Netflix, Amazon Prime, Z5, name a app, and you know, there is an app at home. So, you know, at the end, I would say that if there are, let's say, 100 OTT services launching every month across the globe, because it is not really regulated business. All you need is your app and you can launch your services. You're not needing a license entirely to launch your services. you have to also see that, you know, 100 apps are probably also shutting down every month. Someone who had launched something 7 years back, 5 years back, 4 years back ahead of time could not sustain. And the, you know, the companies are changing hands that way. If I have to answer entirely from the perspective of a market like South Africa, new linear channels are getting launched, new linear platforms are getting launched, OTT services are getting launched. And of course, you know, the Wi-Fi and the internet is not still as that low cost in that market, which means that market will take a little longer than, you know, we have taken it in India, because in India, suddenly everything got fast tracked with the digital economy launched by and the focus of digital by the current government and the Prime Minister. So today we see that Jio actually redefined the definition and the speed of Wi-Fi and internet and the pricing. You know, people were paying certain amount until few years back, and now what we pay is actually, you know, coming at a very, very competitive price. So what the ancillary media and what the other industry is also doing helps actually, you know, at what stage and at what speed do we run?
Yeah, it's a nice insight. As I said, that the OTT platforms, it's not a rivals, it's only a complement to your linear television channels, you rightly said. But at the same time, I would also know your perspective, because you are aware of it. There is a lot of TRPs, the situation, very dicey situation there in Indian market, and there are a lot of debates that's happening. So I try to understand, being a CEO of a leading television channels, and you're part of the launching of different channels. So what's exactly you defined the rating, viewership rating standards, and how, what are the criteria for international viewers rating strategies?
So these ratings and the stuff actually, you know, is actually varying country to country. It's not a, when we are talking on the subject, we cannot actually pick up a wide brush and give one stroke and say that, okay, the whole globe has been painted. This subject actually has to be dealt with a fine brush, which means, you know, what is the regulation in, let's say, a South Africa, the criteria and the rules are very different. The regulator is someone different in the next country who is actually, you know, just touching border over there. So it's a subject which is actually, you know, dealt by the individual governments depending on, yeah, or and the individual regulators depending on at what stage is their business, what are their priorities, and how they are actually looking at handling this subject.
Thank you. Probably moving from television channels and its whole dynamics, I would take you to the next questions, where probably besides managing various television channels in Asia Pacific and particularly in African region, you also undertake a new venture in health and wellness sector in US. So what is the idea to begin with such initiative?
Yeah, you are right, Dr. Panda. So I'm currently involved in our health and wellness business. And, you know, in this health and wellness, couple of verticals we have. And one of the vertical is, it's known as Yovan. And the spelling is Y-O and numeric one. Yovan is a Sanskrit word, and what it means is eternal youth. So we have a health resort in the upstate of New York, spread across 1400 acres, wherein we deal with the health conditions of our clients, of our guests. It's a luxury resort. And over there, we are dealing in naturopathy, we are dealing in Ayurveda and acupuncture, Reiki, yoga, and all of it. And I would say that timing wise, you know, it just seems to be the right timing, because everyone in last 1 year, in 2020, all of us got time to spend a lot at home. So I remember that, you know, since I am born and since I started going to school, it was first time in last few months that, you know, I spent maximum time at my home and I saw what my family does. Because, you know, it was work from home. It was, I could see morning, evening, afternoon, 24/7. And that actually, you know, I would say it was a good thing that happened. All of us started doing pranayam. All of us started doing health exercise and something which is known as yoga in India. The world started to get to know it as yoga. And of course, you know, a few years back, International Yoga Day was introduced by June is the month in which we actually have been celebrating Yoga Day. But then, you know, the yoga is the international phenomena now. And, you know, this gargling with the salt water and steaming and all of us would have seen these videos and would have doctored on what and how to deal with the COVID, right? A lot of us would have seen as to what we need to do. And it's actually, personally, I believe that, look, you know, COVID sits in the nose and the throat. And the best thing is if you can actually, you know, continue to steam every day and continue to gargle, so one can deal with it. So in India, of course, you know, it's a very traditional concept of yoga and naturopathy and Ayurveda. However, we felt that, you know, it's best that we introduce these to the American and the Western world. And I must say that, you know, it's a concept that is doing exceptionally and good in these markets, because, you know, you have to see the happiness of those people when they actually get cured without the medicines and, you know, purely by the nature.
So, as I said, that we are having, it's a privilege being interacting with a multifaceted personalities who started from an engineering graduate, initial part working in a engineering industries, moving to media, then health and wellness. Entirely, I see entirely the journey, and it's the reflection that what we have now today. So perhaps I'm very interested to know that what qualities and attributes to make a leader like you and that kind of a global CEO, what you see, that what kind of attributes required. So it would also inspire our young, budding future leaders.
Okay, so I would say there is no recipe for it. It is purely individual choice, you know. So what worked for me probably worked for me. So I'm not saying that all of you and everyone actually has to do that. Or if you do this, you know, it's actually going to be your journey is going to be my journey. It's not that. But still, actually, you know, I will say as to, you know, what and how I think and what worked for me. First of all, I would actually say that keep life very simple. Don't complicate it. As I said in the beginning also, nature made it everything very simple and human mankind tried to make it complex. So I would say keep it simple. And for peace of mind, it's important that there is peace in mind and there is peace in heart. So you don't have to go out and look for it, actually, you know. If you really want peace of mind, look and get peace in mind first and get peace in heart. And everyone has a plan. All of you will have a plan. Your parents will have a plan. Your faculty will have a plan. Why are we forgetting that maybe God also has a plan? So have faith. Have faith in someone, which I would name it as supernatural. I'm not saying, you know, Allah or Bhagwan or Christ or Baba Nanak. It's all about, you know, I would say there is something supernatural, because a family cannot run without a head. A webinar cannot run without an administrator. And I see that there is an administrator there. And a university cannot run without a dean. So a city cannot run without a mayor. How can world run without someone supernatural? So there is someone who is actually having a plan. So have faith on that. And many times I have seen that when you see there is no solution, you don't see any light. I have also seen that sleep with the problem, maybe, you know, God will give you a solution in the morning and there would be light on the other side of tunnel next morning.
Yeah, it's a fantastic. You make it very simple. Your philosophy about entirely the leadership philosophy, your life philosophies. And as you said, that everything is predestined and pre-planned. Probably I'm asking on behalf of my student. There are a lot of brilliant students who are aspiring to become in media entrepreneurships. So what would be your advice to them? How, and looking at entirely the changes, the pandemic and the 2021, whatever coming, a lot of opportunity they have. So what would you suggest? What kind of tips you would give them so they can start, initiate a lot of media entrepreneurship, particularly ideas?
I would actually, you know, just give one advice, believe in yourself. I will not complicate it by giving, you know, saying a lot more. Believe in yourself. If you have confidence and trust on yourself, I'm sure, you know, you will succeed. And at the same time, while, you know, a lot of students are learning journalism and, you know, one is trying to get specialization, don't forget the multitasking habit of us. Actually, you know, it will be important to keep your mind very, very open. And so don't limit your thought only to what is being taught in the institute. And your innovation has to be your innovation. Don't stop innovating.
Yeah, with this, I think it is a spark. It's an inspiration. It's really engaging. And I believe moreover, it is an enlightening interaction with you. Perhaps if someone there in the panel, I tried to open up this session, if you would like to put any questions, if you have anything to ask, probably the forum is open. Anyone would take up its open kind of invitation. So it's questions anyone can ask. Yeah, Harishji, probably the questions reflect. Can you read it on the screens?
Yes. So this one is about the the radio, and I would say digital radio. We have to also see that. So I got a chance to work for a brief while within the FM industry. While I was working in Times Innovative Media, Radio Mirchi was one of the businesses within the group. It's a good idea. Of course, you know, with the digital technology, launching your own platform and your own radio service has worked very well. I have seen almost a lot of universities, a lot of towns actually have their own local radio stations, which are digital in nature. And the beauty of these digital stations is on IP, you can actually broadcast it globally, which means if I know the frequency, I can actually, you know, just log into your own radio and connect with you people. And there is also an app which actually connects the global FM stations and global radio station or digital stations. You would have seen that app. But you also have to keep in mind that the maximum amount of radio use happens when you are driving, because we want, and everyone want, your eyes on the road and hands free. So that's how actually, you know, with work from home for now, of course, I think, you know, radio was one industry that got impacted for a short while last year and at current time. And all these aggregators, if you look at the set-top boxes and the aggregators anywhere, they aggregate not only the television channels and the OTT services, but they also aggregate the radio stations. So I would say radio is still there, and it has not died. At my with people of my age, I can tell you that it will never die.
Harishji, probably I would happy to inform you that we have our own exclusive radio channels. We call it as a community radio, campus radio. And probably our students, they have done a fabulous job on carrying content and spreading the awareness regarding corona, and closely working with government. And there are a lot of developmental messages they are also spreading across. So they are actively engaged in community buildings. So probably what would your idea that how can we engage our community, and how far this, as you said, that IP radio, how IP radio is effective in engaging your communities, particularly whatever the community you are living?
Okay, so I will actually, you know, try to answer it with my limited experience of how I have used it as a, you know, as a media company. So when I was launching my channels in English and in French, we defined our audience, and our audience are black females aged 20 to 45, LSM 7-8, which means, you know, certain level of earnings, because we are a pay television channel. And so we used extensive community radio stations to reach our audience in terms of channels. Right, which means, you know, we actually had certain portion of the marketing budget that we actually used to spend on at least 24 of the community stations across South Africa and across various countries of Africa.
Yeah, that's very interesting insights. Before wind up the session, I would like to know if you have something like lessons you want to share with our student.
I would say actually, you know, just, you know, positivity is very, very important in life. So you have to actually look at the positive side of life. And I was just trying to see as to what good things happened in 2020. And few of the things, while I have already spoken about the speed with which 5G actually, you know, was fast tracked, you have to also see as to, you know, from in terms of the technology investments and the fintech investments. There are certain, I was speaking to a banker, and the banker was telling me that, you know, the amount of fintech investments which were supposed to happen by 2030, everything got fast tracked by about 5 years. And those amount of investments now are expected to happen by 2024-25, which means a lot of ground has been covered in last 10 months in terms of the technology and fintech. And another good thing is that, you know, before 2020, I had never done a webinar, believe me. It used to be my official video conferences with my teams and, you know, with the clients. It was never actually, you know, that we actually, in fact, webinar word itself was not heard. I used to know seminars, but the amount of webinars and the connectivity that we have been able to establish, every 2 weeks, I have been speaking to one group of people or the other. And so, there are good things also which are happening, and it will continue to happen. Look at the positive side of 2021, and sometime probably it is a good idea to not watch too many news channels, which I personally do. I don't watch TV in terms of the news channels, and my information actually happens from very select. There are certain media houses who actually give you the crisp news every day in the morning, which is actually, of course, not real time, because you get to know about it only in the morning. But it's okay. I'm a traditional person. I had grown up reading newspaper in the morning. I had never got used to reading newspaper in the afternoon and another one in the evening. So I'm okay with this speed of information. Thank you.
So thank you all of you that part of this fantastic and engaging and enlightening webinars. And I believe there is a lot of takeaway, particularly for this webinars. Due to paucity of the time, we cannot take a lot of the questions. But on behalf of the Jagannath Lecture University, I would like to express my deepest gratitude to you, sir, for finding times, for giving your insights, your perspective. And it will take us and our student a long way and in developing and building as a future leaders. So I would like to thank you. And I am also looking forward to have a physical interaction whenever you find time. So I would extend our invitations to please come to this campus. And we would really love to see you here and enjoy your discussion in person. Thank you, and thank you all. Thank you, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Panda. But before closing the discussion, I just want to take one question of our dean, Mr. Divakar Shukla. He asked a question, is wellness a more urban concept or contemporary rural in part of this mindset? And keeping in mind traditional wellness mindset that rural communities worldwide have. So I would actually, you know, try to answer from my own perspective, because, you know, I am not really a big city boy. I was born in a very small town, and I'm still mindset wise live in that small town mentality, and probably that will never grow and become urban. But from the health perspective, I can say that health has no age, no seasonality, and it is very, very universal fact. You know, when I was talking to my health and wellness team, one day they told me that, look, you know, we have a lower bookings in our resort because it's a low season. I can tell you my answer to them was, we are a health resort. Health has no seasonality. All of us actually need health and to be staying healthy every day. Not that, you know, I can afford to stay unhealthy in winter and I have to get healthy in summer. So health is universal concept. The divide between rural and urban, the fact is that those of us, and fortunately there is a very little rural representation right now in this, you know, 40-38 group that we are talking to. Because there is no rural representation, so we may end up saying that, look, you know, health is very, very important for urban people. But from my own perspective, whenever I drive my home, as soon as I am 100 kilometers away from my home, I open up, roll down my windows, and I want to breathe that air, which I believe is the best oxygen I have ever breathed in my life. So I would say health is not really, cannot be divided rural or urban or metro. It's very, very universal fact. And when we make it a business, that's when we have to actually divide these boundaries, rural or urban or metro, because then we say, look, you know, who can afford health? Who can afford us? And then we actually start looking at the metro side and the urban side, and we start ignoring the rural side.
Thank you, Harishji, for extending times and taking off extra questions. Probably it shows that how generous you are and how humble being a CEO. And being honor for us being with you in this particular platforms. And we really look forward for a long-standing relationship with you. And we expect that whenever you find times, please visit to our campus in person, so we can have a lot of this enlightening and engagement discussion with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for having me. And please feel free to reach me, any of you. I am, I think, in the modern Google age, you just need to actually type the name, and now you know the company also. So it becomes that much easy. And then you can actually, you know, pull out the history of everyone and everyday life. And thank you so much. It was really, I enjoyed interacting with you all, and God bless. Thank you. Namaste.
It's an honor for us, sir. Thank you so much.